405 together. 405, a friend I have called Jesus, whose love is strong and true. Would you all stand with me, please, as we sing? It's just like his great love. A friend I have called Jesus, whose love is strong and true, and never fails, howe'er 'tis tried. No matter what I do, I've sinned against this love of his. But when I knelt to pray, confessing all my guilt to him, the sin cloud rolled away. It's just like Jesus to roll the clouds away.
It's just like Jesus
to keep me day by day. It's just like Jesus all along the way. It's just like his great love. Sometimes the clouds of trouble bedim the sky above. I cannot see my Savior's face. I doubt his wondrous love, but he from heaven's mercy sees.
Good singing tonight, man. Singing like Buckeyes. And I say that because Brother Booth is from that state up north. And he's been transplanted to Louisiana, so that helps. But we're praying for revival in his life, and he'll get that settled. But great singing tonight. Boy, nobody sings like God's people sing. And great singing tonight. Looking forward to a good service here this evening. Thanks for being back in church on Sunday night. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, thank you for this evening. Thank you for your great love that you have to us. And Lord, we sure love you. And we know that we only love you because you first loved us. And Father, we bow before you here, and we ask you to make this service what you would want it to be. Pray your music and the singing that we do would be a sweet savor to you tonight. We would sing with grace in our hearts unto you. Lord, thank you for each one who's made their way here tonight. And I pray no one would leave disappointed this evening, but each of us would yield ourselves to you and ask you to work in each of our lives tonight that which is well-pleasing in your sight. Lord, control the service to that end, please. In Jesus' name I ask it. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Well, turn with me, if you would, to 355, Wonderful Grace of Jesus, Greater Than All My Sin. On that verse together, 355, Wonderful Grace of Jesus, Greater Than All My Sin. How shall my tongue? Where shall its praise begin?
All right, some announcements for us now. Listen carefully if you would. Remember, those of you in Grove City School of the Bible, tomorrow night is your class instead of Tuesday, because Tuesday night is our midweek service right here, 7 o'clock, our worker appreciation service. Different service than what we have any other time of the year, and you want to be present for that. It's a great, great time together. Tuesday night, 7 o'clock, right here in the auditorium. And then remember, there's a men's breakfast on December the 3rd. I think there's a sign-up sheet for that down there. Ladies, your Christmas get-together is on December the 5th on a Monday night. And Treasures of the Snow, and you've got all kinds of things happening that night. It's in the bulletin. Make sure you check that out, and you can sign up for that downstairs as well. Our adult Christmas banquet out at Dear Dutchman is coming up. And that's always a great time. And so you see Carol Coleman down in the foyer afterwards, and she'll get you set up for that. That's Monday evening on December the 12th. And I think there's a baby shower for Emily coming up on somewhere in there, the 13th maybe, something like that. That is a sign-up sheet down there as well, ladies. And so make note of that. I believe they're flying in on December the 6th from Uganda. And so we pray they'll have safety as they come home. All right. And I think that's what we have right now. And let's see. Anybody here tonight for the first time? Good to have the Pensacola folks. Paul and Brooke, is that right? Good to have you back tonight. That's great. They hung around town for a little bit and got to come back to church this evening. And glad they're here. And all right. Let's hear from the choir.
Let's go over to number 11. Number 11, long before the fall of man, God designed a master plan. He is mine. Number 11, you can remain seated on that first together. Long before the fall of man, he exchanged a sinner for the sinless one. Jesus left his throne on high, came to earth to bleed and die. He said, Father, not my will, but thine be done. He is mine. He is mine. He is mine. I have pardon. Mercy and his grace is prepared for us a place. Words cannot be there. We will pray. is the perfect Lamb. King of kings, the great I am. He has made ours to share. He is mine. He is mine. I am blessed beyond all measure. He is mine. I have pardon full and free through the blood he shed for me. Safe forever I shall be. He is mine. Amen. Well, let's go over to 492. Jesus Christ has made to me all I need. All I need. 492, let's all stand together if you would. Jesus Christ has made to me all I need. All I need. He alone is all my plea. He is all I need. This very hour, my redemption full and free. He is all I need. He redeemed me when he died. All I need, all I need. I with him was crucified. He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness, this very hour.
My redemption
full and free. He is all I need. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guest. Come back and sing those last stanzas together.
Thank you.
Let's sing that chorus together. Wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness is very are. My redemption full and free, He is all I need. Jesus is my all in all I need, all I need. Let's sing that fourth together. Jesus is my all in all. While He keeps, I cannot fall. He is all I need. Wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness, this very arm. My redemption full and free, He is all I need. Let's sing that last together. When we get to the chorus, we'll have the instruments drop out. Glory, glory to the Lamb, all I need, all I need. Glory, glory to the Lamb, all I need, all I need. By His Spirit sealed I am.
He is all I need.
Wisdom, righteousness, and power, holiness, this very
be seated. Fellas, before you come, grab some of those envelopes there. I meant to do that when I gave you announcements. If anybody wants to give a special offering for Brother Booth, you have an envelope you can put it in to put it in the offering. Won't do a separate offering for him, but if you want to put something in, just slip your hand up. When the ushers walk by your row, they'll give you an envelope to put that in, and you can get that from him. All right, there you go. Thank you. There you go. Got one right here. Just walk down, fellas, and hand them out to the ones who want it. Did they miss you, Miss Jeanette? Yep. Back in the back row. Danny Wright, right behind you. He's going to got. You have any envelopes there, Danny? Okay. Got one. Got a few back there to get yet. Appreciate you doing that, fellas. I meant to do that during announcements, and then it would all have been done. My wife didn't remind me. I'm sure it's her fault. all right. Appreciate Brother Booth. He was here 4 years ago and filled in for us on several occasions. And when I had my hip surgeries, and appreciate so much his faithfulness through the years, and we've supported him since that time, I think, or somewhere in there. And God, you know, he went down and preached for Brother Nip this morning down in Lancaster, and you know, Brother Nip was sharing with me before the service that Brother Nip told him, you know, he's so glad to have him. He says, I don't know any evangelists. That's amazing. I've been pastoring there 12 years. And it's a rare thing. And by the way, part of that is because there's not that many churches that have revival meetings anymore. And maybe that's why we don't have any revival in our country, huh? But, you know, we want God to send a revival. Just do it between 11 and 12 on Sunday morning. That's the deal. So thank God for evangelists, and thank God for men like Brother Booth and his faithfulness. You'll find out tonight that, you know, he preaches the truth, but he preaches the truth in love. And you'll see that. And he's been a real good friend and just a good preacher. We enjoyed him Friday night at Reformers Unanimous, and had a great message there, and looking forward to hearing him this evening. We're going to have the offering. I asked the trio that sang this morning to come back and sing again tonight. I like that song they sang. And you ought to hear that. And I have been blessed. And so I just want to get blessed again. Is that the second blessing? Maybe it is. But we're gonna enjoy that again tonight instead of the one who was going to sing the solo. Graciously said that was fine, that they would allow the trio to sing, so we appreciate that. And we'll hear them, and then after they're done singing, Brother Booth will preach to us tonight, all right? Let's pray, ask God's blessing on our offering this evening. Father, we thank you for the privilege to give, and thank you, Lord, for how you meet the needs of your work through your people. Pray your blessing on the gift and the giver alike tonight. Thank you again for Brother Booth and his faithfulness through the years to preach the gospel and to, Lord, how you used him through the years to influence lives and to lead people to Christ. And I pray that you'll use him again tonight to be a help and a blessing to us. May our hearts be open to what you want to say to us this evening. Bless the offering, bless the special, honor the preaching of your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
When he walks among us, all that he does, all of his mercy, all of his love, the pen of the writer could write every day, even this world could never contain, just how I've been blessed. Warmth in the winter, flowers in spring, laughter in summer, changing of leaves, food on my table, a good place to sleep, clothes on my back and shoes on my feet. I have been blessed. I have been blessed. God's so good to me. Precious are his thoughts of you and me. No way I could count them, there's not enough time. So I'll just thank him for being so kind. God has been good, so good. I have been blessed. Arms that will raise, a voice that can talk, hands that can touch, and legs that can walk, ears that can listen, eyes that can see. I've got to praise him as long as I breathe, 'cause I have been blessed. A father and mother who nurtured and raised, brother and sister and memories made. Our pastor to lead us, this altar to pray. Stripes that can heal and the blood that can save. I have been blessed. I have been blessed. God's so good to me. Precious are his thoughts of you and me. The way I could count them, there's not enough time. So I'll just thank him for being so kind. God has been good, so good. I have been blessed. We live in a country, the greatest on earth. The flag stands for freedom and what it is worth. She stands in the harbor, Miss Liberty calls. All have gave some, but some gave it all. Me to be blessed. In her shoulder to lean on when I am down. The rock where he leads me when I'm overwhelmed. Place where he hides me under his wings. He's not just a song, he is the reason I sing. I have been blessed. I have been blessed. God's so good to me. Precious are his thoughts of you and me. No way I could count them, there's not enough time. So I'll just thank him for being so kind. God has been good, so good. I have been blessed. God has been good, so good. I have been blessed.
Thank you so much. That's one of my favorite songs, and so true, isn't it? We've sure been blessed. Thank you, Brother Slaybaugh, for allowing me to come and be here tonight. And I appreciate the opportunity. We came from over by Toledo, Swanton, little farming town over there. I preached Wednesday night. And Brother Slaybaugh said I could come over and stay in the missions apartment for a few nights, and I appreciate that. Because I didn't really want to sleep out on the street, and he was gracious, and I've enjoyed that, and we've been able to spend a little time together and listen to one another eat, and it's been wonderful. I've enjoyed the fellowship, always enjoyed the fellowship, even though he does persecute me about being a Wolverine fan. We enjoy the fellowship anyway. And I appreciate the opportunity. I do want to say thank you sincerely from the church for the support. Most people can never understand how much that helps. But we have times that we're in churches where we get very little offering. And sometimes we go for a period of time without meetings. The Lord knows we need to spend more time in prayer. And that helps immensely. And I appreciate it very much. So thank you, church. And I want to say we certainly need your prayers. I do have 18 grandchildren now, and Christmas is coming. So I really appreciate your prayers. And my son that pastors in Iowa, they just in August had number 8. And I told him, son, there are other ways to build the church. I think he's holding out for a television program. And but anyway, the Lord's been good to us. And so good to see so many familiar faces, many of that just been here through the years faithful. And boy, I tell you, the longer I serve the Lord, the more I sure am thankful for faithful folks. Just stay with it and keep serving the Lord, and that's wonderful. And then some new folks I've met, and that's a blessing. I love the auditorium, just looks beautiful. I love the color scheme, everything about it. Just, man, it just uplifting, isn't it? And so the Lord's been good to you. That's a blessing. And I'm sure glad to be able to spend the evening here. I want you to open your Bibles tonight, if you would, to Matthew chapter 6. I've been away from home for 15 days today. I'll fly home tomorrow, and so I'm glad to get home for a few days. Some folks had asked, and I wanted to update you about this. Some folks had asked about my wife's health, and I appreciate that very much. And she is doing better, and we're very grateful for that. Really, she's doing the best she's done in the last 20 years. And her health is never going to be real, real good, you know, but she's able to go with me occasionally. About every 6 weeks, she'll go with me for about 2 weeks, and that's about the length that she can take. And then she gets home and says, I don't know if I can go with you again. And then about 2 or 3 weeks later, she says, I think I can go in a couple weeks. So, and so I praise the Lord for that. Thank you for your prayers. And a couple of weeks together, she says, that's enough of you. Now leave me at home and go get me a couple more love offerings. So that's where I'm at. Matthew chapter 6 in your Bible. Just to bring you the background here in Matthew chapter 6, we come to the place the Lord is teaching his disciples and really is using the Pharisees as a negative example. And you know, the Pharisees were all about themselves. It was all about self-serving. Their motives were about getting a pat on the back and everybody recognizing them. And they're all about things and prestige and image, you know. And boy, I tell you, it grieves me today how many independent Baptists are so enamored with image. You know, and we got a whole political scene that's all about image. No integrity, but a lot of image. And that's, the Pharisees were like that. And they would pray, you know, big flowery prayers out in public so everybody would think they were real spiritual, you know. And they would give so that everybody would know how much they gave, so everybody would think they were really something. And so the Lord's teaching his disciples, and notice what he says to them there in chapter 6 and over in verse 8. He says, be not ye therefore like unto them. Don't be like them. Go to your closet and pray. Give where the right hand doesn't know what the left hand's doing. Don't be in that mode and frame of mind where you're always looking for self to get the glory. And he goes on now over in verse 19, some familiar verses to us that say, lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. The light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. But if thine eye be evil, thy whole body shall be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? No man can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. And so the Lord tells him here, he says, if you're going to be followers of me, you're going to be my disciples, you've got to make choices in life. And you've got to choose between two treasures. You've got to make a choice whether you're going to invest your life in things on this earth where moth and rust can corrupt, or whether you're going to invest your effort and time and talents in things that are going to be eternal, where moth and rust can't corrupt and thieves can't break through nor steal. But you got to make a choice. You got to make a choice what kind of vision you want. You're going to have that single vision where you run the race looking unto Jesus, or you're going to have that double vision of trying to follow me while you're trying to serve yourself at the same time. For he says, if you have that evil vision or that self-centered vision, he said, then the old devil's going to lay those traps in front of you. You're going to walk in darkness and fall right into those traps. But if you follow me and you have that single eye that is running the race looking unto Jesus, and he's the priority and the answer for everything in your life, you'll walk in the light, and the Lord will shine upon your path so you don't fall into those traps that Satan sets for you. But you got to make a choice. You got to choose between two visions. You got to choose between two treasures. And then he says, and you got to choose between two masters. For no man can serve two masters. Been 38 years in full-time ministry now at this point in my life. I got to tell you something. The most miserable people I've ever known in my life are Christians trying to serve two masters. But you can't serve two masters. It's not like it's an option. He says no man can serve two masters. We know that clear back in the Old Testament. You remember when Moses received the tablets on the mountain. And if you'll go back to Exodus chapter 32 with me. In Exodus 32, and here Moses and Joshua come down from the mount. You remember they were having that rock and roll party, and they'd convinced Aaron to build the old calf like they'd learned about in Egypt, and they got the music of Egypt, and they decided they were going to have a big party, and they were weary because they said, why is it that Moses has been so long on the mount? You know, he's just left us out here to die. And isn't that a challenge for us as Christians? You know, we always want to rush God to our timetable. But patience is one of the most important things in the Christian life. God has his perfect timing for everything. But they got in a big rush. And they, man, you know, just, he's not coming back. Just throw in the towel. Let's go back and practice what we learned in Egypt. So they built this golden calf. And they're worshiping this golden calf. And they're singing these wild songs. And now Moses comes down from the mount. He's got the tables of stone in his hand. Look at verse 15 of Exodus 32. And Moses turned and went down from the mount. The two tables of the testimony were in his hand. The tables were written on both their sides. On the one side and on the other were they written. And the tables were the work of God, and the writing was the writing of God graven upon the tables. And when Joshua heard the noise of the people as they shouted, he said unto Moses, there's a noise of war in the camp. And he said, it's not the voice of them that shout for the mastery, neither is it the voice of them that cry for being overcome, but the noise of them that sing do I hear. And it came to pass, as soon as he came nigh unto the camp, that he saw the calf and the dancing, and Moses' anger waxed hot. I like Moses. Amen. He got angry. Can I tell you something? In independent fundamental Baptist churches today, there is a push for preachers to lighten up. One guy wrote in a book, he said, you know, we've had too much mean-spirited preaching. We just need to back off some. We need to lighten up. Can I tell you something? It depends on how you want to define mean-spirited preaching. But you better define that, because the Lord Jesus said to the Pharisees, you bunch of whited sepulchres full of dead men's bones. Pretty tough. You know, Paul said about the Cretans, they were liars and slow bellies. Was that mean-spirited? You know, you better define what that means. I'm not for being obnoxious, and I'm not for being crude and rude in the pulpit. But I want to tell you something. We need preachers to get stirred up about what's going on. And there's some things that a preacher needs to take a fit about. We got a bunch of junk going on in this. Who would have ever thought in our wildest imaginations that we would have a government trying to push transgender bathrooms? It's nuts. But the problem is we've got too many preachers that are so worried about offending anybody and worried about losing a crowd that they're not giving people the truth like we need to give it to them. So Moses, he got angry. And notice what happened. In verse 19 it says, and he cast the tables out of his hands, and he brake them beneath the mount. And he took the calf which they had made, and burned it in the fire, and ground it to powder, and strawed it upon the water, and made the children of Israel to drink of it. Whoa. I mean, he ground up that golden calf, put it in water, and made them drink of it. It's the first case of powdered milk in the Bible. I just like to pass on those words of wisdom to help folks. And then notice what he said to the people. Go over there in verse 26. Then Moses stood in the gate of the camp and said, "Who's on the Lord's side? Let him come unto me." I mean, Moses drew the line in the sand and he said, "All right, you're going to serve God or not? Make a choice. You're going to serve the Lord? Get over on this side." You know, Joshua kind of did the same thing, didn't he, at the end of his life when he was about ready to die, and he called all the elders of Israel together and he gathered them up and he said, "Hey, listen, you're going to have to make a choice. You've got to make up your mind. You need to choose whether to serve the God on the other side of the river. You need to serve the true God. But as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord." Got to make choices. I want you to understand tonight, God did not create you to be a master of your own destiny. You heard that from Oprah, not from the Bible. He created you to serve Him. And every man is created with the purpose to serve. Every man. Look over at Colossians chapter 1 with me. Colossians chapter 1. It's right before Colossians chapter 2. Try to help the preacher's wife a little bit. Colossians chapter 1, look at verse 16. "For by Him," talking about our Lord, "were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by Him and for Him. And He is before all things, and by Him all things consist, and He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things He might have the preeminence." We're created to serve Him. Look over at Revelation chapter 4 when it tells us about the crowns that are being cast at the feet of our Lord. And look at Revelation chapter 4 and verse 11. And here's what they're saying in verse 11. "Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for Thou hast created all things, and for Thy pleasure they are and were created." You see, there is a philosophy being pushed today that's a common, you know, popular Christianity, so to speak, today. The Joel Osteen type of Christianity that says, listen, if you give your life to the Lord, He'll make all of your dreams come true and everything you ever wanted. Now, He'll always make you happy and He'll do everything you ever dreamed of. And I want to tell you something, folks. God did not put me on this earth and create me so that He could fit into my plans and my program. I'm supposed to fit into His plan and His program. We're created to serve Him. And I want to tell you, you will serve something because you're created to serve. And Romans 6:16 says, "Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, His servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness." Every person will serve some master. Satan, self, or the Savior. But you'll serve some master. So I want to just give you a few practical thoughts tonight on that. Number one, I want you to understand, we're not saved to be a master, just a servant. We're just saved to serve. Ephesians 2:8-9, "For by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourself, it's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." Verse 10, "For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath foreordained that we should walk in them." Every child of God has a purpose to serve the Lord in some capacity. I don't know what your purpose that He created you to serve in. We know some things in the Bible are clear. We know He wants all of us to be soul winners. We know that He wants all of us to be faithful. But there are some specific abilities God gives us that we're to use for His glory, to fit into His plan and His program. And He's got all of that figured out. We're to serve. And there's another popular philosophy being pushed today that says, you know, God's not really interested in what you do. He's just interested in who you are. Now that sounds real sweet, but is it scriptural? Well, let's look at the Word of God. Look over at Titus chapter 1 with me. In verse 16. It says, they professed they knew God, but in works. Well, that kind of sounds like he's interested in what we do. In works they deny him, being abominable and disobedient and unto every good work. Reprobate. Look what he says over in John 14. Here the Lord says in verse 12, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. Well, it sure sounds like he's interested in what we do. You see, it's just an excuse that the new evangelical philosophy wants to throw out there to make you feel like it doesn't matter how you dress, doesn't matter where you go, doesn't matter how you talk, doesn't matter what kind of testimony you have. You know, God just loves you for who you are. And that is destroying old-fashioned Bible-believing Christianity. Is he interested in what we do? Well, it sure sounds like it. Look with me, if you would, over to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Look at verse 9. Paul says, wherefore we labor that whether present or absent, we may be accepted of him, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body, according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. You see, that's talking about the time we don't oftentimes preach about, but it's talking about the bema judgment. This is not talking about the great white throne judgment where the lost will stand before the Lord, be cast into hell. This is talking about the time that awards are given out. And the Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians 3 there will be rewards and loss of rewards. And this that time. And the Bible says that it's for we who are believers, we who are Christians. And thank God we're not going to have our sin thrown up to us. That's under the blood. Isn't that wonderful? Thank God for that. But it will be a very sobering time. Because you're going to stand before the Lord. And can I tell you, folks, you're not going to stand before the Lord as a church. You won't stand before the Lord as a family. You're going to stand individually. And you're going to look into those eyes that know everything about us. And you're going to see the scars in his hands and the wounds in his side that will be reminded for all of eternity that he was the lamb slain for us. And that's who we will stand before. And you know what he's going to say? What'd you do? What'd you do? Hey, Booth, I allowed you to grow up in a Christian home. You had a mom and daddy teach you the Word of God from the time you were little. What'd you do with it? I allowed you to grow up in America where you didn't have to sneak off to some hidden place to be able to come and worship. I allowed you to own a Bible. What'd you do with it? You were in a church where the preacher was faithful to preach the Word of God to you. What'd you do with that? I mean, you knew how to lead a soul to Christ. What'd you do with it? I gave you a job that most people across the world would love to make the income you're making. What'd you do with that? Did you tithe? Did you give to missions? What'd you do? I was traveling to preach a missions conference. And just as the Lord would design it, I get on the airplane. I'm flying into Chicago, and next to me in the seat is a young man, and he's probably in his early 20s, so I struck up a conversation with him, introduced myself. He said, my name is Bud. I said, well, it's good to meet you, Bud. I said, are you going to see family? He said, oh, no, no. He said, just an acquaintance. And I said, oh, or where are you from? He said, Holland. I said, oh, Holland, Michigan? I said, my wife was from Michigan. Oh, no, no. He said, I'm not talking about the state of Michigan. He said, I'm from Holland, the country Holland. And I said, wasn't that interesting? Here I'm going to preach a missions conference. The guy from Holland sat next to me. And I said to him, I said, Bud, did you grow up going to church any? He started laughing. He said, sir, I've never seen a church in Holland. He said, none of my friends, I didn't know anybody that went to church. He said, now I heard some rumor that there might be a little church down in the village somewhere. There's a handful of real old people that might go there. But he said, I didn't know anybody went to church. And I said, Bud, I said, have you ever seen a Bible? He said, no, sir. I said, do you believe in God? He said, well, I don't. He said, I guess if I was in deep trouble, he said, I wouldn't think of calling on a God. And so I began to share. I said, you're very intelligent, obviously. I said, certainly you're smart enough to know that everything that's around us, trees, everything has a system of how they grow and how they get their nourishment. I said, surely you're smart enough to know that that had to be an intellectual design that put all that together. And I said, that name of that intellectual design is God. And the amazing thing is that Creator loves you and He loves me. And I said, He gave us a book called the Bible that explains about His love. And I told him about Jesus. And he just listened. Before he got off, of course, he didn't trust Christ, but he listened. And before he got off, he said, who knows, maybe someday you'll go to Holland and start a church. But I walked off that plane and I thought to myself, God, why were you so good to me? God, why were you so good to me? I could have grown up in Holland. I could have parents that never talked about a church. And that day when we stand before the Lord, He's going to say, what did you do? What did you do? You see, we're created to serve Him. That's why we're here, to serve Him. Well, I want you to also understand tonight, you can't serve too. You can't serve two masters. It's not an option. You're going to make a choice. You see, really, the Christian life, as we read in the New Testament, the Christian life is really an all or nothing proposition. I'm talking about living for the Lord is really an all or nothing proposition. You know, the book of Matthew, it tells us where the Pharisees or the scribes try to corner the Lord Jesus, you know, in that intellectual corner, and they said, what's the great commandment? He said, well, that's easy. He said, the first and the great commandment is love the Lord your God with all of your heart, all of your soul, all of your mind. It's an all or nothing proposition. You remember how many times he called the disciples to follow him, and in each case he said, forsake all. And today we're hearing of a Christianity that doesn't want to forsake anything. I'm telling you, to follow Jesus, everybody you read in the Bible, they forsook to follow Him. It's an all or nothing proposition, folks. I don't recommend that the next time you get on an airplane, you put one foot on the plane and one on the ground and say, go ahead, I don't want to be too fanatical. That's not good for your health. Please, on your next vacation, if you go on a cruise ship, don't put one foot on the ship and one on the dock and say, go ahead. That's not good. The Christian life doesn't work when you're half-hearted either. The Christian life doesn't work when you're trying to serve self and you're trying to serve the world and you're trying to serve the... It doesn't work that way. You can't serve two masters. I was preaching in Texarkana, Arkansas. The pastor I met at a preacher's meeting, and he said to me, Brother Booth, he said, you know, the former pastor was real well thought of, had a wonderful testimony, older man, and he died with cancer. He said, you know, I was the assistant pastor, and now I'm the pastor. And he said, but I'm going to be gone over the Christmas holidays. This a couple of years ago. He said, would you come and preach for me the Sunday after Christmas? And I said, sure, I'd be glad to. Not easy to find a place to preach in that time of the year for an evangelist. And so I was grateful, and I went up to preach for him, and And the former pastor who had died, his wife is still living, and she was still in the church, and they had five children. And all five of the children were married to pastors or were pastors. And they were all there to be with mom over Christmas. So in that service, we had all of those son-in-laws and sons that were pastors. And man, it was wonderful. We just hit it off. And one of the son-in-laws, pastors in Texas, he came up to me afterwards. He said, "Brother Booth," he said, "do you know who Bobby Bonner is?" I thought to myself, man, that name sounds familiar. And I like sports, you know, and I thought, man, wasn't he a ball player? He said, yeah. He said he played for the Baltimore Orioles. He played with Cal Ripken. He said he said, in fact, Cal Ripken said of Bobby Bonner, he was the best infielder he ever saw play the game. That's quite a compliment from Cal Ripken. And he said, Bobby Bonner got saved. And he's kind of mentored me in my Christian life. I said, really? He said, man, read his testimony. It's amazing. So I did. It's an amazing story. They were on their way to the World Series. Earl Weaver was their coach. And Bobby got saved while they were on their way to the World Series. He was playing the infield. And he got so excited about being saved, he just couldn't help himself. He began to witness to everybody. Brought his Bible into the dugout, and you know, and old Earl Weaver got mad about it. He said, Bobby, this isn't church, it's baseball. Leave your Bible at home. Bobby couldn't help himself. He just kept witnessing to everybody. And finally, Earl Weaver got mad, and he cut him. He sent him down to AAA division. And it was just before they were going to the World Series. He said, I'll give you a check if we win the World Series. I'll give you a ring. But he cut him, sent him down to AAA. He was such a good ball player in AAA, they voted him most valuable player. And at the end of the season, five different major league teams came up and offered him a contract. And Bobby said, you know what? I dreamed of playing Major League Baseball since I was a little boy. But he said, I think God has something different for me now. And he walked away from five Major League Baseball contracts. Shortly after that, his pastor took him on a missions trip to Africa. And while he was in Africa, he gave his testimony. His pastor preached. And after that, an African native man came up to him, a young man, and he said, sir, he says, I need you to go and tell my family. He said, they've never heard anything like that. I'm from the inner bush, and I need you to go with me and tell my family. And he said, okay, that'd be great. You know, and he's thinking someday. And the man said, no, I mean tonight. And Bobby thought, man, I'm exhausted, but man, he's burdened. We need to go. Him and his pastor went back into the inner bush. And when they got there, they built a little campfire, and his family got all around, and they began to explain about the Lord Jesus and about salvation. And boy, they had 1,000 questions, you know, and they kept asking question after question, and pretty soon the sun's beginning to rise. And the entire family trusted Christ. And he didn't realize that as they looked up and the sun was beginning to rise now around the perimeter, the village had gathered. And they all moved in and said, you got to tell us. And so they continued on, and they gave the gospel to them, and they explained and answered questions for several more hours before they left. That entire village trusted Christ. And Bobby got back home. He said, I believe I know what the Lord has for me. He's an older man now. His health is not the best, but in his lifetime he started well over 200 independent Baptist churches in Africa. He got a phone call from Cal Ripken that said, Bobby, we're going to have a reunion of the old team, the World Series team. And he said, I want to invite you. And he said, well, I wasn't part of that team. He said, sure you were. He said, no, Cal, don't you remember? I got cut. He said, well, you got a ring and a check, didn't you? He said, no, I didn't get any of that. He said, well, I don't care. You're my friend. I want to invite you to come. And he thought, well, that's a blessing. I'll get to go see those guys again. So he went to that reunion of that old World Series team. Earl Weaver was there. He walked up and stuck his hand out and said, "Hey, Skipper, good to see you." Earl Weaver dropped his head and he said, "Bobby, I can't believe that you'd even want to shake my hand." He said, "Jim Palmer reminds me every day of my life that I ruined the career of one of the best ball players ever to play the game." And Bobby Bonner looked at him and said, "Earl, you didn't ruin my career. Let me tell you what happened." And he began to share with him the tens of thousands of African souls that are saved because God sent him to Africa. No tears were dripping off that crusty old baseball manager. And I want to tell you this, folks. I tell you that story to say this. You can't serve two masters. You can only serve one. And I want to tell you my last point of the message. There's only one worth serving. There's only one worth serving. You see, he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. He's the goal of our race. He's the prize that we press toward. He's the escape when we're tempted. He's the rest from our heavy yoke. He's the way, the truth, the life. He's our incorruptible inheritance reserved for us. He's our never-ceasing intercessor. He's the friend that laid down his life for us. He's the propitiation for our filthy sin. There's only one worth serving. Nobody's ever regretted at the end of their life that they served him. He's that friend that'll stick closer than a brother. Everybody you ever come in contact in this world, If you give them enough time, they'll disappoint you at some time or another, but not him. He's always faithful. There's only one worth serving. Because you see, the Bible tells us in Proverbs 13:15, the way of the transgressor is hard. And young people, I hope you pay attention. If you got a young person that's sleeping, poke them and get them to listen. Hear me tonight. I want to tell you something. To serve any other master, the old devil's a hard taskmaster. He's a hard taskmaster. He lies, he deceives, he'll cheat to set you up to ruin your life. There's a mama about ready to go get some groceries. She said to her 15-year-old son, "Son, I need to go to the store. I'll be a couple hours. Now listen, son. Promise me you won't do anything stupid while I'm gone, son. I know that you know where the extra keys are to the car, but you're only 15. Don't do something stupid while I'm gone." No, Mom, I won't do anything." As soon as she backed out and headed down the road, he got on the phone. Hey, called his buddy. "Hey, man, listen. I got the keys to the extra car. We've got a two-hour window. We can have us a good time." Jumped in the car. He backed out of the driveway. He was heading down the road, dropped something, and he reached over to get it, and all of a sudden he realized he's over the line, and he tried to correct, but he overcorrected, and he came back over the line and head on into another car. The one thing the boy did right was he had a seatbelt on. There was a policeman just about a block down the road, saw the whole thing. He drove up quickly. While he was driving up, he could see that the boy was trying to get out. All the windows were broken in the car, and he's starting to get out of the car, and so he knew at least the boy's breathing, he's alive. The other car was just a crumpled mess, and so he went over to the other car, and when he looked inside, he saw there was a lady inside. Her body was almost severed in half. He reached to try to feel for a pulse, but as he expected, there was no pulse. He got into her purse and he pulled out her driver's license, and he began to write the information down on his pad of paper. And by this time, the boy is out of the car, but he's terribly shook up. He's nervous. He's standing next to the car, and the policeman walks over to the boy and he says, "Son, you give me your driver's license." And the boy said, "Sir, I'm sorry, I'm just 15. I don't have a driver's license. He said, but give me your name and your address. The boy gave him his name and address, and he began to write it down, and then he stopped. He looked up and he said, son, would you give me your name again and your address? And gave it to him again, and he said, son, are you sure? He said, officer, I know my name and address. He said, but you see, your last name and address is the same as the deceased lady in the other car. Can I tell you something? The devil is a hard taskmaster. You think you're doing your own thing. Preacher, not going to tell me what to do. I'm sick and tired of everybody trying to tell me. And, you know, all these rules and I'm tired of all that. And, you know, you're falling right into the devil's trap. He knows what he's doing. Hear me tonight. I wish I didn't know as many stories as I know. People that you try to warn and you try to tell them, and they're so bent on serving another master. Nobody's ever happy serving another master. An evangelist that's in heaven now, he was beginning preaching a revival meeting, and just as he was out ready to go up to the pulpit, there was a father that came up to him in the crowd and said to him, sir, please, I just ask you, would you pray that my daughter comes tonight? She's just 16, but she's just gone wild. We can't control her. She's just absolutely gone wild. And he said, I begged her to come tonight. She's with some boy we don't approve of. And he said, yes, sir, I'll pray that she comes. Just as he got up to start his message, he looked in the back. That girl and her boyfriend walked in. They sat in the back row. Old time he preached, they cut up and laughed and mocked. And when he got to the invitation, he said, heads bowed and eyes closed. And they wouldn't bow their heads or close their eyes. He said again a second time, would you please bow your head and close your eyes? And they wouldn't. So he said one more time, I'm asking you, please, just out of courtesy, would you please bow your head and close your eyes? That boy reached over, grabbed that girl's hand, stood up, laughed, and gave that evangelist an obscene gesture, and walked out. And afterwards, the dad came up and he said to the evangelist, he said, did they listen any? He said, they didn't listen too well. He said, well, please, I'm asking, would you be willing to come over to the house after the service tonight? My wife and I, we've got some cookies and refreshments, and I've already talked to the pastor, and he said he's willing to come, and we'd like you to come, and we just need some encouragement, some fellowship. And he said, sure, I'll come. And so after the service, the pastor and his wife got in their car, and the pastor and evangelist got in the car, and the husband and wife got in their car, and they led out, and they were following them out in the country where their house was. And they came around a corner, and the car was smashed into a tree. Nobody was around. They pulled over. The dad got out of the car. The pastor and the evangelist got out of the car. They started across the road when the dad said, that's his car. That's his car. And suddenly, as they're about halfway across the road, a car exploded into flames. The last thing he saw was that precious little blonde-haired, blue-eyed 16-year-old girl with her head sticking out of the flames and crying, Daddy, do something, Daddy, do something. He couldn't do anything. I only tell you those stories to tell you this. Listen to me tonight. The devil's a hard taskmaster. He's a tormentor. He's a destroyer. There's only one that's worth serving. I preached my daddy's funeral about a year and a half ago now. My dad was my hero. He was a Marine Corps hero in World War II. But he loved the Lord with all of his heart. And I preached my dad's funeral, and my dad was a preacher. My brother, my two sisters, I'm the youngest. You know what dad left us? Mom went to heaven about 5 years ago. You know what Dad left us as far as material things? Nothing. He was a preacher. You know how much any of us cared? We didn't care because he left us a far greater heritage. A love for the Lord, serving the Lord. Nobody regrets that. You've probably heard the story, but I like to tell it about old William Borden. He was that son of that mega millionaire of the Borden family and fortune. William was 18 years of age and graduated from high school. His dad gave him a trip around the world for his graduation present. He was already worth millions as an 18-year-old boy. And he went on his trip around the world and he was saved. And he said every port they stopped at, all he could see was millions of souls that were lost, that needed Christ. By the time he got back, he knew God wanted him to be a missionary. And his desire was to go to China to win Muslims to Christ in China. And so he went to Bible college and was preparing. And as he was preparing in Bible college, everywhere around him was kids that had needs and families that had needs. And he just began to give his money here and give his money there and just trying to help people. And pretty soon he'd given everything he had. And he went back to his Bible, and in the front of his Bible he wrote, "No reserve." It wasn't long in his studies that he got word from back home, and his father had suddenly died. And the family said, "William, please, you know, can you put this on hold, this missionary stuff? You know, you're the sharpest of the family. We need you to run the business. You'll make plenty of money to be able to go to the mission field later." And William went back to his room, and he wrote, under no reserve, he wrote, "No retreat." He finished preparing. He got on ship on his way to China. They stopped over in Egypt at a port. And while he was there, he got a terrible disease, cerebral meningitis. And in 30 days, young William Borden died without ever reaching the mission field. When they gathered his stuff together, they found his Bible, and they saw where it said, "No reserve, no retreat." And then it said, "No regret, no regret." Nobody regrets being faithful to the Lord. He's a rewarder. He's the best master. He's always got your best interest at heart. Regardless of what trials he lets us go through, regardless of what heartaches we go through, he always has our best interest at heart. He knows what's best for us. Back in the days that they didn't have any hymns or hymn books, Isaac Watts wrote hymns. And one of the first hymns that Isaac Watts wrote was for the Lord's Supper. And this is what he penned. "When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss and pour contempt on all my pride. See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow mingled down. Did e'er such love and sorrow meet, or thorns compose so rich a crown? Were the whole realm of nature mine, that were an offering far too small. Love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. No man can serve two masters." Let's bow our heads for prayer. Our Lord, we love you tonight. Thank you for being such a wonderful master. I wish I'd been more faithful for you, Lord. But I love you tonight. Thank you for the privilege we have to serve you. And I pray you'd help each of us tonight to allow you to examine our hearts, examine our faithfulness to you as our master. Maybe there's some tonight they need to come to an old-fashioned altar and confess that you've not been the priority, you've not been the preeminent one. That their goals, their dreams, their joys and are centered around other things than you. We're not faithful in the Word of God you've given us, opportunities you give us. And to think of that day, Lord, when we stand before you and say, what did you do? Would you help us tonight, Lord? Maybe some of us need to get some things in order with thee. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed, nobody looking. And I'm asking you tonight, can you say, Brother Booth, thank God I know I'm saved. Thank the Lord I remember where I was when the Spirit of God convicted my heart. I knew I was going to hell and I knew I deserved it. And somebody took the Bible and showed me from the Word of God how I could trust Christ and be saved. And with a repentant heart, I called on the Lord and trusted Him as my Savior. And Brother Booth, I'm 100% sure if I died right now, I know I'd go to heaven because I've trusted Jesus as my Savior. If that's your honest testimony, would you indicate that by raising your hand? Just raise it up and then put it down. Thank you. And I ask you tonight, how many would say, yes, thank the Lord I'm saved on my way to heaven, but the truth is I needed that reminder tonight. The Holy Spirit of God spoke to my heart, Brother Booth, somewhere during the challenges of life and the journey on this earth. I get a little distracted, and He's not the preeminent one, and He's not the true master. And Brother Booth, somewhere during the message tonight, the Holy Spirit of God convicted my heart. As a Christian, there's some things I need to get settled with the Lord. Pray for me. Would you slip your hands up, Christians? God spoke to your heart tonight. God bless you. God bless you. Thank God for your tender hearts. Thank you. May put them down. Maybe there's others. Maybe something I never mentioned specifically, but the Holy Spirit mentioned specifically to you. You say, Brother Booth, I didn't raise my hand, but I should have. God's dealing with me tonight. Include me in the prayer. Slip your hand up if there are others. Yes, that's God bless you. Glad we waited. There are others. Yes, ma'am. God bless you. God bless you. I wonder tonight who might say, to be honest with you, Brother Booth, if I died right now, I'm not sure I'd go to heaven. I've been struggling with doubts about that, not sure that's settled. If I could know for sure, according to the Word of God, that I was saved, forgiven, and on my way to heaven, I'd like to know that for sure. Please pray for me. Would you slip your hand up? Just put it up and put it down. I see some little hands. Just stand with me for prayer, please. After I pray, the music will play. God spoke to your heart. Let's not hesitate. Let's come and do business with God, whatever He's dealing with your heart about. Heavenly Father, again, we love you. We thank you for loving us. Thank you for your precious word and the power of it. And pray tonight, Lord, that you'd help us, God, that whatever you're dealing with hearts about, that folks would be humble enough to come and yield to thee, Lord, and that they'd receive that grace needed, Lord, to have victory, and truly that there'd be a difference made in hearts and lives for your glory. And Lord, we just pray that you'd give victory so they'll bear eternal fruit for thee. Nobody raised their hand to be saved, Lord, but if there's somebody that needs to be saved, would you draw that heart to come and let the preacher know that they need to be saved? Do your mighty work now. We'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. As the music plays, God spoke to your heart. You need to come, you come. Others are already at the altar. You need to join them. You come, would you?
Oh, to Jesus,
you raised your hand. I can't do anything more than pray for you. Now's your opportunity. God, deal with your heart. Come on. How would it be, Him looking at you tonight and saying, what did you do? What did you do? I gave you all these opportunities to serve me. What did you do? You need to come. You come.
To thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus, I surrender. Humbly at His feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken. Take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. Thank you.
Sing that chorus together, will you?
The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. The more that I love him, more love he bestows. Each day is like heaven, my heart overflows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows.
Just heard a man, served him 38 years, testify, the longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. And there's no life like the Christian life. The fella said, I've been around the millionaires, and I've never heard a millionaire say, I'm satisfied with money. But I've been around enough Christians to hear them say, I'm satisfied with Jesus. Amen. And it makes a difference. Be seated just for a minute, would you? Bill, do you have those cards? I talked this morning about a note. Appreciation, dish those out so guys can pass them out, will you? Many of you know on Tuesday evening, usually during our service, we allow you to write on a 3x5 card. Maybe you write just you don't sign your name on it or anything, but just somebody you appreciate or what you appreciate about someone or what you're thankful for, and you just write that on a card. And I thought instead of doing it so quickly at the service, I'd give them to you tonight, and then you have till Tuesday night to spend some time and put some thought into that. And then bring them with you Tuesday evening. We collect them, and we just read them. It's not something you have to put your name on or anything, but, you know, sometimes people don't even, they think nobody even notices them or nobody even cares, and boy, for somebody to say, boy, I appreciate so-and-so, they're here every service, or they always have a smile for you, or they always have a handshake, or they always, you know, and you never know what that means to somebody, to get a note of appreciation, and this is an opportunity to do that. And express your gratitude to someone else and let them know that they're a blessing to you. So the ushers are going to get you these cards. Come on down. You working on it, guys? We could have had two in the middle and two on the end, you know. There you go. I wouldn't hurry you, but Brother Booth gets real hungry, and he gets real mean when he's hungry. All right. Thank you, guys. Appreciate your help. All right. Thank you for doing that. All right. Remember the sign-up sheets down below. If you need to get signed up for any of the things that are coming up, get plugged in. And remember now, Grove City School of the Bible tomorrow night, and our midweek service Tuesday night, 7 o'clock. You can come Wednesday night, too, if you want, but have service any way you want it, I guess. Huh? Okay. Okay. You can go down there. All right. All right. All set? All right. And you can just put them on the table back there, guys. If somebody wants to pick up an extra one or two, you're welcome to do that. All right. Let's stand together for prayer, shall we? Father, thank you for a wonderful day today in the house of God. Lord, it sure has been good to be here. I'm glad I was in church this morning, and I'm certainly glad I was in church tonight. Thank you again for the message, and thank you for Brother Booth. Lord, I pray that your hand will continue upon his life and his ministry, and be with his dear wife as she gives him up to spend periods of time away from him, Lord, so that he can be a blessing to churches like ours. I pray you'll give him safety as he flies home tomorrow, and Lord, continue to have your hand upon his life and ministry and use him for your honor and glory. Father, thank you for your hand upon our church. Thank you, Lord, for faithful people who love you. Thank you for people who've made their decision. They're going to serve Jesus Christ with their life. Now, Father, dismiss us with your care. Give us a good week this week. Make us mindful of your presence as we leave this place tonight. Help us to do those things that are pleasing in your sight. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. Let's hear you sing it. Here we go. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. It's a grand thing to follow Jesus anywhere and everywhere I go. For it's a grand thing to be a soldier in his army here below. It's the grandest thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. God bless you. You're dismissed.